I'm a trainer by profession. My question is like this. Das Anthony mentioned about universal brotherhood, and doctor also mentioned that the similarities, the way we... Das Anthony mentioned, he mentioned various religion. I would just like to ask this. Will it be okay for people of a different faith, let's say Christians? Can Christians refer to their gods or the God as Allah?
Brother asked a very good question. That can people of other faith refer to their God as Allah? The answer was given in my lecture, that if the God who you call as Allah fits in this four-line definition, you can refer, otherwise you can't. And I gave you a sample, a test, that there are some human beings in the world who call Bhagavan Rajneesh to be God. Now, when you put Bhagavan Rajneesh to the test of Surya class, it fails. So if you call Bhagavan Rajneesh as Allah, it is totally wrong. The same way the God you are worshipping. Which God do you worship as?
I am from the Christian faith.
According to Christian faith, I am a student of comparative religion. I know what Bible says. I have studied the Bible. I can quote the Bible from my mind. I am asking you, who do you believe to be God?
The creator of earth.
Yes, creator, no problem. But do you believe Jesus to be God?
Jesus is the son of God.
Son of God. If God has son, then he's not God. Then... Bible has got sons by the tons. If you read the Bible, Adam was son of God. Ephraim was son of God. Israel was son of God. All those who are led by the Spirit of God are sons of God. In that idiom, anyone who followed the commandment of God is a godly person. In that way, I've got no problem. In Hindi, we say, beta idhar aao. So no problem, beta. But if someone says, janava beta, that means he's insinuating. So only calling son of God is a good word. But if you say begotten son, do you believe Jesus is begotten son?
Jesus is the son of God.
The son of God, even Ephraim is son of God, Israel is son of God. So do you mean that Ephraim and Israel is same as Jesus, peace be upon him?
I think it would not be fair to question in that manner, because if you were to see Christianity from a Christian point of view...
Not Christian point of view. I see Christianity according to Bible point of view.
Okay,
if you want to understand any religion, go to the scriptures. If you want to understand Islam, don't look at me. Don't look at Muslims. You analyze the Quran and the Sahih Hadith. If you want to understand Christianity, you have to study the Bible. If I have to understand Hinduism, I have to study the Vedas and the other scriptures. So what you have to know is that as a student of comparative religion, I'm a student of comparative religion. I've studied the Bible. I've studied the Vedas. I've studied the Quran. And we have question and answer session for people to correct us. If you disagree with me, you have a right to disagree, but you have to tell me why. So I've given the talk here, and I know the concept of God according to Bible very well. I'm not bothered what the church says, because for me, Bible is important, not the church. So similarly, as far as the question is concerned, you can call the God you worship as Allah if your God fits in this four-line definition. So in this four-line definition, even your Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, does not fit, and even Jesus Christ, peace be upon his father, does not fit, because God cannot have son. So both of them you cannot call as God. Hope that answers the question.
So doctor, you disqualify Christians from calling Allah simply because of the fact that Christians believe that Jesus is the son of God.
So that's the reason. If he's the son of God, begotten son, I disqualify. Because this statement, what you say, son of God, is referring to your Bible, Gospel of John, chapter number 3, verse number 16. I'm quoting. And know that very well. Gospel of John, chapter number 3, verse number 16 says, God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, whosoever believeth in him shall not die but have everlasting life.
Doctor, the way you are seem to be answering my question, the spirit you are answering my question, the essence you are answering my question, doesn't seem to be promoting this brotherhood between you and me. It is putting a separation between you and me.
Correct, because if you go against the Bible, I will separate from you. If you are towards the Bible, I'm with you. Anyone, any human being who wants to create disharmony because he's going away from a scripture, I will not agree with him. Because you are going away from the scripture and going towards your church, I'm saying go back to your Bible. You quote the Bible. I'm giving references. What you are saying is that out of your own mind. Now, if you try and take the Christians away from the Bible, I will not agree with you. You quote the Bible, and you quote the verses what Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, spoke, there is not a single unequivocal statement in the complete Bible where Jesus Christ, peace be upon himself, says that I am God, or where he said worship me. And I told you, if any Christian, anyone in KL or in Malaysia or anywhere in the world shows me from any version of the Bible where Jesus Christ, peace be upon himself, says that I am God, or where he says worship me, I, Dr. Zakir Naik, am ready to accept Christianity. If Christian means a person who follows the teaching of Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, we Muslims are more Christian than the Christian themselves. Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, according to the Gospel of John, he was circumcised on the eighth day. Brother, are you circumcised?
No, I'm not.
I'm circumcised. So I'm following the teachings of Jesus Christ, or you? If you read the Bible, it's mentioned in the book of Ephesians, chapter number 5, verse number 18, don't have alcohol. It's mentioned in the book of Proverbs, chapter number 20, verse number 1, that do not be drunk with wine. Brother, do you have alcohol?
I have never tasted alcohol in my lifetime.
But the Christians as a whole have or not?
Say again?
The Christians have as a whole or not?
I haven't.
I'm asking the Christians as a whole.
I haven't.
The Christian as a whole, do they have or not?
I haven't. I would not want to speak for other
Christians. Fine. You don't have. Or do you have pork?
Say again?
Do you have pork?
Yes, I have.
Okay, now I'm quoting you. If you read the Old Testament, if you read the book of Deuteronomy, chapter number 14, verse number 8, in the book of Isaiah, chapter 65, verse number 2 to 5, in the book of Leviticus, chapter number 11, verse number 7 and 8, it says you should not have pork. I don't have pork, you have pork. If Christian means a person who follows the teachings of Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, we Muslims are more Christian than the Christian themselves. I'm promoting communal harmony. I'm quoting a Bible, and Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, said in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter number 5, verse number 17 to 20, if you break one jot or tittle from the Old Testament, you shall never go to paradise. One law if you break of the Old Testament, you shall not go to paradise. I am more Christian than the Christian themselves. I can go on and on. I can go on and on talking about the similarities. There are differences. I am not here to talk about difference. I am talking similarities. But the problem is, if you say Bible is the word of God, why aren't you following the commandments of the Bible? Why? So this is the problem with the followers, that when they want to follow the scripture, what my solution is, simple solution. One simple solution. I tell that at least believe that one book is the word of God. So Christian would not mind, okay, fine, I agree, Bible is the word of God. The Hindu will say, I don't mind believing Veda to be the word of God. The Muslim will say, I don't mind believing Quran to be the word of God. I tell them, let us agree to follow what is common in all these three scriptures. What is different, we'll discuss tomorrow. Right or wrong, we'll discuss tomorrow. Let us agree today that let us follow 100% what is common in all these three scriptures. As I told in my lecture, that all these scriptures talk about one God. This God has got no images. He has got no picture, no portrait, no father, no mother. I have given quotations from the Old Testament, from the New Testament. I have given quotations from the Old Testament, New Testament, from the Vedas, from the Quran. Point number one. Let us agree there is one God. Worship him alone, not Trinity. Not triune God, one God. Next, I had given a talk yesterday in Jawabaro. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the major world religious scriptures. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is not only mentioned in the Quran, he's prophesied in the Old Testament, in the New Testament, in the Hindu scriptures, in the Vedas, in the Upanishad, in the Puranas. He's prophesied in the Parsi scriptures, in the Buddhist scriptures. Let us agree to believe that Prophet Muhammad is the last and final messenger. So easy. All the scriptures say don't have alcohol. Bible says don't have alcohol. Quran says don't have alcohol. The Hindu scripture, Manusmriti, says don't have alcohol. Let's stop having alcohol. So easy. Bible says do hijab. All the ladies should do hijab. They should cover their head. Only you see nuns and Mother Mary. You know Mother Mary? Mother Mary, her photograph is just like a Muslimah. Properly covered. But when you see the other ladies, no. If you read the First Corinthians, chapter number 11, verse number 5 and 6, it says the woman that does not cover her head, she dishonors her head should be shaved off. Even in Islam, in Quran, it doesn't say that the woman who uncovers the head should be shaved off. This is how strict the Bible is for the woman to cover her head. But most of the Christian women we see, the head is uncovered. So I'm trying to get communal harmony, not discord. So please don't come here and say things which are wrong.
Say again?
Please don't come and lay allegation against me. I'm bringing co-relationship. I am bringing communal harmony. That's the different thing that you want to go away from your Bible. I want to get you closer to your Bible.
Thank you. Now I feel that it is not fair just because you follow certain things in the Bible, you become more Christian than Christians. I follow a lot of things which is also in the Muslim faith. And I know a lot of things the Muslims themselves don't follow in the Muslim faith. I'm sure you'd agree with me. But would that make me more Muslim than Muslims?
There is not a single statement you can give in the Quran as a whole. Not you may be better than one individual Muslim. He is a namesake Muslim. Muslim means a person who submits his will to God. If he says he submits and he does not submit, he's a pseudo-Muslim. He will not go to Jannah. He will not go to Jannah. Just by saying that I'm a Muslim will not take him to paradise. I will openly say that. Unlike in your Christianity, that you believe Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, died for your sins according to your church, and you go to heaven. That's not part of the Bible. That's the teaching of the church. So I'm here to promote communal harmony, to let people know. And what I'm telling is quotation directly. You tell me what is common. You tell me one thing in the Quran which I don't follow. Show me one thing. Tell me one thing. One thing in the Quran.
I can see something common in what both of us are saying.
Sorry?
One, I can see something common.
There are many things common, not something common.
I can see something common. I can see. I didn't say you can see. I said that I can see something common in what both of us are seeing.
There are many.
I can see that there are some Christians who do not follow Christianity as well as they should. And I can see there are some Muslims who do not follow what Islam teaches as they should.
Not some Christians. According to statistics, majority Christians don't follow. According to statistics today, there are 7 billion people in the world. The people who profess the Christian faith, they may be close to 2 billion. The people that profess the Islamic faith, more than 1.5 billion. But the people who follow, the majority in the world are Muslims. Majority. The Christians, they don't follow. So as a whole, the religion, we have black sheep in our community, but as a whole, the religion which is maximum followed, the teaching of any religion, that is Islam. I know there are black sheep in our community. There are many black sheep, but as a whole, as a percentage, today's statistics tell us the religion which is maximum followed, the teaching based on the Quran, on the scripture, is number one Islam. That's the reason today the fastest growing religion in the world is Islam. Brother, what's your, if you have any question,
Yes,
you can pose a question or go behind the queue. Yes, brother. Pose your question.
I just like to end by saying, I would like to say that, I rephrase. There are some Christians who are not following the Christian doctrine. There are some Muslims who do not follow the Muslim doctrine. I would end by saying, however, I would not want to boost my ego by saying I am more Muslim than Muslims. Thank you, sir.
Brother said there are some Christians who don't follow. Not some Christians. Majority people who claim to be Christians are not following the Bible according to statistics. And I do agree that there are some Muslims who are black sheep who are not following. Those who don't follow the scripture, those who go against the Quran, they are not true Muslims. They may be part or they may be pseudo. But you can never say, never ever can you say, until you accept that there's one God. And Prophet Muhammad is the messenger of God. You can never claim to be better than the Muslims.
Can we have the next question from this mic?
My name is Tina. I'm a pharmacy student and I'm a Hindu. Dr. Zakir, I just want to ask, you're from India. I'm not so sure whether you're familiar with this practice in among Indians. Regarding this leave, that you go and consult someone, and if you manage to find your leave based on thumb print and other things like that, your whole life, your name, parents' name, past, future, what's going to happen is all written in that leave. I don't know whether this is a practice of Hinduism or is something made by the temples or people. And if so, if everything is already written, how is it comparing Hinduism or maybe this practice with Islam, fate and free will? Thank you.
The sister posed the question that there may be certain practices in India about picking up leaf. which mentions about a future. There are different types of practices. It may not be part of the scripture, but there are different types, mainly talking about the future. Jyotish, you know, go to Jyotish, to a fortune teller. Go to a fortune teller, different types. You see on the streets, there are many cards kept, and a parrot goes and picks up a card, and then they read, and that talks about the future. You go to a machine, put your date of birth, and the machine tells you something. Now, based on this, you go, it's very common, and people make a fast buck out of it. I'll first tell you about it. There was a psychologist in States who taught a class of 100 students, and at the end of a week, he said, I will tell you about your past to each student. And he wrote to each student separately. He gave them a chit. He said, don't open. You open together, and after you open, you tell me how accurate was I in my talking about your past. So all the students open, and 95% of the students, they said that the professor was more than 90% correct. 5% said that he was 80% correct. The key to it was the professor wrote the same thing for everyone. For example, you go to a machine and give a birth date, and the machine will tell you something bad is going to happen in the next 10 days. Even if 100 good things happen, something bad will happen. The next person, the machine will say that something good is going to happen. Even if 100 bad things happen, something good will happen. So most of these things, talking about the future, it's a big fast.
Sorry, I just wanted to say, because like my family, it's a thing to do this. So my leaf was found and they read it. So things in it, like, because, you know, science student try to think logically, rational, whether it's possible. Because sometimes when some things they say, for example, this is your mother's name, they got it correct. This is your father's name, they got it correct. And I think it's in Sanskrit, so it's like you have to believe entirely what the guy is saying, because you can't check it yourself, whether it's right or wrong. I think I was 16 when I read it, so they said the age where you read it was 16. There's two, like, maybe out of 10 things, 8 things he got correct. And it's like sometimes I try to think, how do they do this? And it seems a lot of people also come. So it's like this logic and the faith, there's a fight there. Which should I believe?
I'll just come to it, sister. Let me complete my answer, and that will cover your question also. As I was saying, that most of the people that do is a big fast. It's a big gimmick, just to make fast money. What Quran says, which I mentioned in my talk, Surah Maida, chapter 5, verse number 90. Ya alladhin amanu, O you believe, innamal khamru wal maisuru, most certainly intoxicants and gambling. Wal adabu al azlamu, dedication of stones, divination of arrows, rishthu min amali shaitan. These are Satan's handiwork. Fashtanibun alakum tufliun. Abstain from the handiwork that you may prosper. Here Quran says alcohol, gambling, fortune telling, and dedication of stone. Fortune telling is same. These are Satan's handiwork. Abstain from it that you may prosper. Quran does not say that no one can predict the future. See, many Muslims don't realize what the Quran says. Alcohol, gambling, fortune telling, dedication of stones, these are Satan's handiwork. Abstain from it. Quran does not say no one can predict the future. But most of the people who predict the future, they are just doing a gimmick to make fast money out of it. Based on the Quran and the hadith, we come to know that there are hadith of the Prophet Muhammad, that there are jinns who listen and they pass on the message to certain people. We as Muslims should not be involved in it. It is prohibited. But that does not mean no one can predict the future. Most of the people who claim are all wrong. But there may be certain human beings who can predict the future. But we as human beings should not indulge in it, whether it's right or wrong. It will be bad for us. So based on this, the Quran says you should not indulge in it. Quran does not say you cannot. There are many people who talk about palm reading. And there are times when some people are 50% correct, some people are 70% correct. If you put heads or tails, 50% will be right, sister. No, heads or tails, 50% will be right. So some people do it just by chance. There may be few, maybe a very small percentage, who may have the art of knowing about the past. That is mentioned in the Hadith of Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. But we as Muslims should not indulge in it. We should not indulge in black magic. We should not indulge in fortune telling. Why? It will cause us harm. So in this context, sister, we as Muslims are not allowed. There may be a very small percentage which may tell quite a major portion of your past or of your future. A very small portion. But we as Muslims are not allowed to indulge in it. That's a commandment. Like how we are not allowed to have alcohol, we aren't allowed to gamble. So indulging in it is not good, it is prohibited. The same thing I'll tell you, that as a human being, if you agree that Quran is the word of God, the Quran does not allow a human being to indulge in it. It will be nothing but loss in the long run for you. Hope that answers the question, sister.
Now, I mean, like, now once I've already seen it, I rather would have not seen it. But because now you know it, and then it's stuck here, it's a bit difficult sometimes when you want to just believe in fate or free will. And then in this context, do you believe that we can still practice free will or is on fate?
Sister asked a question that if you know what is happening, then can you practice free will? As I told you, there's no one you can say who can 100% talk about the future. So even if you're, like you said, out of 10 things, 8 are coming correct. You may never know the thing which hasn't come correct yet will come correct or not. So you yourself said 80% correct. So it may come, may not. So it's in the free will. As far as Islam is concerned, Islam, we have to believe in destiny, that is Qadr. It's one of the pillars of Iman that we Muslims should believe in Qadr, in destiny. I will tell you what is destiny as far as Islam is concerned. That is clearly mentioned in the Quran that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when a child is born, the father is worn on the neck. It's mentioned in the Quran. Everything what you're going to do, Allah knows. But that does not interfere with your free will. Allah has given a free will. For example, if a teacher is teaching in a classroom for 1 year, just before the final examination, the teacher predicts that this student, he will get first class. He'll come out first in the class. This student, he'll get second class. This student, he will fail. And just an example, brother, don't feel bad. Now, when the examination takes place, after the results out, this student comes out first class first, he gets second class, this student fails. Now, can the student who failed tell the teacher, because the teacher predicted I will fail, therefore I failed? Can he blame the teacher? Yes or no? No. Why? Because the teacher knew this student intelligent, used to do his homework, used to attend the class throughout the year, this student average, this student used to go for movies, play hooky, bunk school. So teacher predicted. Same way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is ilm-e-gaib. Now the difference between the teacher and Allah, the teacher as a human being can make a mistake. Can be right 99% but not 100%. Always Allah has ilm-e-gaib. He has knowledge of the future, but he has given you a free will. For example, you come at a crossroad. There's road 1, 2, 3, 4. You can choose any. You choose road 2. So Allah knows in advance on this particular date, on the 29th of September, you will come at a crossroad. You will choose road 2. It is not because Allah has mentioned you will choose road 2 you're choosing. It is because you will be choosing Allah road in advance. For example, after you pass standard 12th, your A-levels, you can either become a doctor or engineer. You choose to become a doctor. So Allah knows in advance that after you pass your A-levels, you will choose to become a doctor. Choice is yours. Not because Allah has written you have become a doctor, because you have chosen, Allah wrote in advance. Now once you have come at a crossroad, 1, 2, 3, 4, you have taken road 2, you come at another crossroad, A, B, C, D, E. You choose road D. Allah knows in advance that when you come at the next crossroad, you will choose road D. So it is because you will be choosing Allah road. Otherwise people will say, it's mentioned my taqdeer, I will commit murder, I committed murder, who's to blame? Allah is to blame, not me. If it's mentioned my destiny, I'm going to rob, I robbed, who's to blame? Allah is to blame. Allah gave you the option that after you finish your college, you can either rob or earn by doing hard work. You choose to rob. So Allah knows, after you finish your college, you could do hard work or you could rob. You choose to rob. So you can't blame Allah. Allah knows in advance, Allah is ilm-e-gaib. So there is something like taqdeer, destiny, in Islam, but Allah has given us the free will. Allah has given us the free will, we are responsible. Otherwise, then where is the test? And Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Mulk, chapter number 67, verse number 2, Alladhi khalaqal mauta wal hayata. It's Allah who has created death and life to test which of you is good indeed. This life, sister, is the test for the hereafter. So that's the reason Islam says, don't indulge in fortune telling about the future. Now, as you're saying, something is always clicking here. So you may think that he may have told you, okay, at the age of 30, you'll die. So you may be thinking, oh, I'm going to die. You may not die. So what if you have done a mistake? Forget it, sister. Take it out. You lead your normal life. Try and find out which is the truth. What you have to do, sister? Do a research. Do a research of various religious scriptures. Which is the true scripture that will give you serenity, calmness, peace of mind? Read that scripture, follow it, and forget what the fortune teller has told you. Even if it comes out to be right, no problem. You do what you feel is right based on your research. That how to lead a life. So this Quran, sister, is the last and final guidance given by Almighty God to humanity. It's not meant only for the Muslims or the Arabs or the Malay. It's meant for the whole of humanity. And if you read this book, inshallah, you would get peace of mind. I request the volunteer to gift you a copy of the English translation of the Quran. You read it, inshallah, it will give you peace of mind.
Thank you.
Come to answer the question.
Thank you. We will come back to mic one.
I request the non-Muslim brothers and sisters, this is the opportunity to ask questions. Please feel free, though the moderator said you have to ask questions on the topic. For non-Muslims, there is a concession. You can ask any question on comparative religion, whether it be Islam, whether it be Christianity, whether it be Hinduism, whether it be on the topic, outside the topic. This is the opportunity. Normally, after religious talk, the person who gives the religious talk doesn't have open question answer session. Because if you have open question answer session, the poll will open up, you know. So normally after religious talk, you don't have open question answer session. I like having open question answer session, and the question answer session is better than the talk because it's a dialogue. You know, talk is a monologue, one-way talk. It's a challenge for me also. And you have a right to question me. You have a right to disagree with me. Only tell me the reason. If I'm at fault, I will agree. If not, I will correct you. You can even criticize the Quran. Please feel free. This is the opportunity. Normally, you don't get such opportunities after religious talk where you can ask any question. You can ask any question on comparative religion. I request my non-Muslim brothers and sisters, please come to the microphone, make a queue, ask the question, something which is troubling you. Maybe before you came here, which was troubling maybe 2 years back. This is the opportunity. I will try my level best. Even if you criticize Islam, I'm young, I can take it. No, I've got white hair, but I'm young, mashallah. Yes, brother.
Mundasya janajana slakhaya shakshum liptam vina tasmai shri gurave namaha ukam karuti vachalam bangam langai tingri yat kripa tamaham vande shri guru dinatarinam. My name is Chaitanya Haridas. By profession I am a lecturer, but I also do cross religious studies. Actually I have prepared a question, but that question is not so relevant to the topic today, and because this question was with me for many years, so I'm going to change the question that's relevant. Especially respected Dr. Zakir, you have mentioned about the Vedas, the Upanishad, and all the some of the Ishopanishad. But I like to quote a quotation here from Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 3, Chapter 11, Text 35, which says, Purushaya Paracharya Brahma netra maham adbhuta kalpa yat bhama brahma sat brahmati yam viduhu. The meaning is, in the beginning of the first half of Brahma kalpa, where Lord Brahma appeared, then Brahma's life, there is a millennium called Brahma kalpa. The birth of Brahma, the birth of Vedas was simultaneous with Brahma's birth. So here it's mentioned that Lord Brahma takes birth after birth, and the Vedas appeared when he take a birth. So based on the literatures, Lord Brahma's age, full age, is 311 trillion and 40 billion years. And if we go in that calculation, I think many of us here are bewildered. But this is the quotation from Srimad Bhagavatam. Another thing, why I mentioned this, because Dr. Zakir have mentioned that the Vedas says that the Lord don't have a form. But the same Vedas also mention the Lord have a form. I quote another verse from Brahma Samhita, chapter 5, text number 1. It says, Ishwara Parama Krishna Sachid Ananda Vigraha
Anadir Adir Govinda, Sarvakaranam Karanam, Ishwara Parama Krishna. It says, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Krishna, is the Supreme Controller, Ishwara Parama Krishna. Sachit Ananda Vigraha, Sat means, Sachit Ananda means eternal, blissful and full of knowledge. So he said, Sachit Ananda Vigraha. Vigrahaya refers to the form, a transcendental form, which is given in the Vedas. I think when we do a research on the particular scriptures, I prefer that we have a whole idea that the Vedas also mention about the form. And I have many other quotes which says that the Lord have been realized in different forms.
Which Veda are you quoting, brother?
This is Srimad Bhagavatam.
Srimad Bhagavatam is not part of the Vedas. Vedas are four: Rig Veda, Yajur Veda, Sam Veda, Atharva Veda.
Yes, I agree with that. Fine? But Brahma Samhita is the commentary by Brahma.
Don't quote commentary, quote the text. If you follow the commentary of the Quran of Quran is written by human beings. You quote the text. As far as Vedas are concerned, there were many Vedas. Today, there's Rig Veda, Yajur Veda, Sam Veda, Atharva Veda.
Yes, that we also
there
have 18 Puranas, 108 Upanishads, 108 Ishopanishads.
Brother, you ask the question, let me reply.
And we have Iktisas.
You ask the question, let me reply.
Okay.
As far as the Hindu scriptures are concerned, the Hindu scriptures are divided into two types, Shrutis and Smriti. Shruti is considered to be the word of God, revelation from God. In it, you have the Vedas, you have the Upanishads. Then you have the Smriti. Smriti is considered to be written by human beings. There you have the Itihas, Ramayana, Mahabharata, Bhagavad Gita as part of Mahabharata. Then you have the Manusmriti. So between the two scriptures, the Shruti is superior than the Smriti. If there's a clash between a Shruti and the Smriti, you have to follow the Shruti, not the Smriti. Because Shruti is higher. Same way with the Quran. We have the Quran, then we have the Hadith. If there's a hadith which is not sahih, it clashes with the Quran, then we keep the hadith aside. What we have to believe in Quran and the sahih hadith, authentic saying of Prophet Muhammad ﷺ. There are certain things which people have manipulated. So when such manipulated hadith comes, what we do? We reject it. So now I am quoting you Veda. Veda is the highest. No Smriti can go against the Veda. If it goes against the Veda, we reject the Smriti. We follow the Shruti. This I'm talking from Hindu scholars. As far as the Vedas are concerned, the Vedas speak, if you read Dayanand Saraswati, the founder of Arya Samaj, correct? In the Vedas, it only talks about God who has got no image. I know there are other scriptures like Manusmriti and Itihas in which it talks about God having image. But a lower scripture cannot overrule a higher scripture. When there is a conflict, you have to follow the higher scripture. That's the reason I have quoted you Veda. So if you get me a quotation from any book which is a Smriti, it cannot overrule the Shruti. Point number one. Point number two, even if you get me quotation, if there's a contradiction in the Veda, then why follow a book which has contradiction? You take out one contradiction in the Quran. Quran says in Surah Nisa, chapter number 4, verse number 82, Afala yadadabburun al-Quran, walau qana min indi ghairillah, lawajudu fi ikhtilafan kaseera. Do they not consider the Quran with care that if there were contradictions in it, it would never be from God? If there is a contradiction, then that book is not the word of God. Do you understand? So we as students of comparative religion, what we have to do, I am here to talk about similarities. I know there are many things which are differences in Quran and the Bible, Quran and the Veda. I am here to promote peace and harmony, not animosity. Therefore, Quran says, come to common terms, as between us and you. I know there are many things which I don't agree with the Veda. I'm not going to tell you about that. Why? Because that will create animosity. So my thing, what I told you, let us agree to follow what is common. What is different, we'll discuss tomorrow. So let you and I agree, if you consider Veda to be word of God, I consider Quran to be the word of God, let us agree to follow what is common. What is common is 100% the word of God according to you and me. But if you selectively don't follow passages of your scriptures, why be selective? You tell me anything from the Quran which I don't follow, I will say sorry and I'll start following. I don't claim to be a very 100% Muslim, but alhamdulillah, as far as what's my capacity, I try and follow everything of the Quran. You point out a single verse in the Quran, whether you believe the Quran is the word of God or not. You point out a verse and inshallah I'll follow. The same way when I am doing the same thing with the Bible, with the Vedas, if the Christian believe the Bible to be the word of God, if the Hindus believe Veda to be the word of God, you have to follow. I know there are contradictions, but I am not here to talk about the negative point of the scripture. I challenge anyone to point out a single contradiction in the Quran. There is none. As far as the age of the Veda is concerned, according to Swami Dayanand Saraswati, the Veda is 1,310 million years old. But the majority of the scholars today of Hinduism say the Veda is approximately 4,000 years old. Today the scholars say we don't know to whom the Veda was revealed, in which part of the world it came. There are differences. Quran, everything is authentic. Yet the scholars believe, even though we don't know what is the exact age of the Veda, even though we don't know where and which part of the world it came the first time, even though we don't know which sage it came to, yet the Hindus as a whole, they believe Veda to be the most sacred. Because they believe, I respect it. I may not agree everything of it. Because I respect, I try and take out the commonalities. So as I told you, Vedas talk about Natasyapati Masti, of that God there are no images. Upanishads talk about that, Vedas talk about it. So if you get me a scripture which is lower, does not contradict, it cannot overrule the Vedas. And if you tell me that there are verses in the Veda talking about, then there's a contradiction. So you as a Hindu, you have to try and find out why this contradiction is there. No book of Almighty God, if it's in its true form, can have any contradiction. Same thing, we believe. Quran mentions Injil. The Wahi which was given to Isa alayhi salam is the word of God. But the present Bible, I can point out hundreds of contradictions. I don't want to do it. I know I'm a student of comparative religion. So what I say, the present Bible is not 100% the word of God. It's a mixture. It contains the word of God. It even contains the word of the prophets. It even contains the word of the historians. It even contains pornography. I'm sorry to say that. It contains obscene things. So me as a student of comparative religion, I'm not here to criticize the Bible. I'm talking about commonality. Let's come to common terms. If I try and criticize, that will bring animosity. There are certain passages of the Bible I cannot read to you. Even if you give me $1 million, I cannot read. Even if you give me $1 million to me and say, read this passage in front of the audience, I cannot. Because my religion doesn't allow to read obscene things in front of the audience. You understand, no? But I'm not here to degrade the Bible. I'm talking about common things. Same thing with the Hindu scripture. As far as the Quran is concerned, the language of the Quran is so sublime. You can read anywhere in the world. You can read to your wife, you can read to your children, you can read to your father. But certain passages of the Bible, I cannot. So here, brother, I've come for communal harmony. And based on that, I have done research on the Hindu scriptures, on the Jewish scriptures, on the Christian scriptures. Unfortunately, people of most of the religions, they blindly follow what is mentioned by the church, what is mentioned by the temple. What we have to do is we have to ask them for proof. Ul hatu buranakum in kuntum sadikin, but if you're truthful. So that's the reason what Dr. Zakir Naik says in Islam is zero. Chapter number, verse number. If I say alcohol is prohibited, it carries no weight. Allah says in Surah Maida, chapter number 5, verse number 90, alcohol is prohibited. So based on this, brother, I am trying to get the Hindus, the Christians, the Jews, the Muslims together to come on a common platform and at least agree to follow what is common in the scriptures so that universal brotherhood will increase. Hope that answers the question.
But Dr. Zakir, I think you're limiting the knowledge that is in the Vedas. Vedas contain all the knowledge. That is what Vedas mean. So if you say, I only take the Smriti, not the Smriti, so that is limiting, because in the way that we are taught, okay, I'm saying there's not one word in the Vedas say Hinduism. So, but always we'll talk about Hinduism. Hinduism comes in the few thousand years ago. Only words there is Sanatan Dharma. So okay, I'll come to it.
See, you're asking question, I'll reply, but every question requires an answer which takes few minutes. I'm not saying don't follow Smriti, but if there's a contradiction between the Smriti and the Shruti carries more weight. For example, you go to a doctor who's a specialist, heart specialist, who's done DM in cardiology, and a general physician, MBBS, who's talking about heart. Who will you believe? Suppose a mother has a heart attack. After MBBS, MD, after MD is DM. He's DM in cardiology. Will you follow him or will you follow MBBS doctor for heart specialty? Suppose a mother has a heart attack. Who will you follow?
The one I have faith with.
So Sorry? When you have faith, who will have faith more? As a logical person, a DM of heart specialty or MBBS doctor?
Even the person can have higher...
If you don't know both of them.
I knowledge, maybe he is not experienced.
But you have two people, you have come first time to a country and one has DM, one has MBBS. Who will you take your mother to?
The one who have a D.
Correct. So similarly, when there's a contradiction between Shruti and Smriti, you have to follow Shruti. That's what the Hindu scholars say, not I. Anywhere in the world. So you have to tell Hindu scholars are wrong. Now coming to your word. See, every time you're asking a new thing, I have to clarify. You said the word Hinduism is not there in the Hindu scriptures. Correct. Jawaharlal Nehru, Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, in his book Discovery of India, he says the word Hinduism is not there in any Indian literature until the Arabs came to India. This word Hindu was given by the Arabs. The Arabs gave the word Hindu to the people who live in the land of the Indus. Even today when I go to Saudi, they call me Hindi. So Hindu is a geographical definition. The word Hindu was given by the Arabs, people living in the land of Indus. So Hindu is a geographical definition for the people living in the land of the Indus Valley. By geographical definition, I'm a Hindu. By geographical definition, I'm a Hindu and a Muslim. Indian Muslim, Hindu Muslim. But if you say Hindu, means those who believe in worshipping idols, then I'm not a Hindu. According to Swami Vivekananda, Hinduism is a misnomer. The right word should be Vedantist. Because they follow the Vedas. Hinduism is a misnomer. It was a word, a title given by the Arabs when they came to India. And today also it has stuck on. Even today when I go to Saudi, they call me Hindi. Yes, I'm a Hindi. And I'm proud to be a Hindi. But I don't believe in doing idol worship. So coming to Hinduism, this is a misnomer. The right word is Vedantist or can be Sanatana Dharma. I agree with you. And Sanatana Dharma believe that God is one and God has got no images. Show me one person who's a pure follower of Sanatana Dharma who says that God has got image. That means you have not studied Sanatana Dharma. Have you studied Sanatana Dharma?
I'm still studying. That's why I say.
Still studying, is, yeah. You are yet studying. You have not passed MBBS also yet. You have not passed MBBS also. Quran says in Surah An-Nahl, chapter number 16, verse 43, and Surah Anbiya, chapter number 21, verse number 7, Fas'alu ahli zikri in kuntum la ta'lamun. If you don't know, ask the person who's an expert. So I hope that answers the question. Brother, you can, for next question, you can go behind the queue, behind the other non-Muslims. Thank you, brother.
We will move to this side of the mic.
My name is Shah. I'm a psychology student. Okay, previously, doctor mentioned that Allah is God, and not just for the Muslims, but also for the non-Muslims, for the blacks, for the whites, as doctor quoted earlier. So, okay, I can accept that Allah is God for everybody. But there was an incident a few years ago on this date called September 11, when there were two towers which were filled with... I would presume that they were of the Christian faith, these American citizens. And these two towers were knocked down by an aeroplane, which was hijacked and controlled by, from what I have heard, controlled by Muslims. So in that sense, what I see is that the brother is killing the brother. And I just want to know what doctor has to say about that.
This is a very good question. Referring to 9/11, September 11 just passed away a couple of weeks back, that the Twin Towers was there, it was knocked down by a plane, there were majority Christian in it, knocked down what she heard, and she's very clear, mashallah, she heard that Muslim controlled the plane. Sister, till now, it's only a hypothesis. It's a hypothesis that Muslims were there, it was 19 Arabs who hijacked the plane, and they banged on the Twin Towers. According to 75 scientists, American, all of them Christian, according to 75 American scientists and professors, if you have seen the documentary Loose Change, Loose Change is a documentary made by a young American. He takes interviews, and these 75 scientists and professors say that we cannot ever believe that 19 Arabs can hijack a plane and knock into the Twin Towers. It is an inside job done by the White House. White House, you know White House. Now I hear everything. I'm hearing from the news Arabs have done it. I'm hearing from news that Muslims have done it. They found the passport of an Arab in the plane crash, which burned the pillars and all the iron rods, but did not burn the passport of the Arab. So someone wrote that next time they should make the army suit of the Americans in that passport material. I've given a full lecture on its terrorism, Muslim monopoly. It is so effective. My lecture is so effective that the Westerners don't want to be in the country today. My lecture is so effective, so logical. These people, these Americans, I'm quoting, I'm only giving you statistics, that they had an interview with the person who made the Twin Towers. He said that it's impossible that the fuel of the plane can melt the Twin Tower. And if you see the photograph, it was the Twin Tower came in stages as though there were bombs planted in advance. There are many hypotheses. For example, there's a boy who's speaking on the mobile. Mother, mother, I'm Mark Binham. I'm Mark Binham speaking. Point to be noted, at that time in 9/11, 2001, more than 10 years back, mobile could not reach that level. Point number one. Point number two, when a son speaks to the mother, why will he say Mark Binang? When I will speak to my mother, I'll say Zakir. I'll not say I'm Zakir Naik speaking. When I speak to my mother, I'll say I'm Zakir. I'll not say Zakir Naik. So what you realize, they're trying to make a story and blame. And that person on the mobile told the mother that it was Muslims. So all these documentaries you see, Loose Chain, Fahrenheit, many documentaries. If you ask me who did it, I would say I don't know. But as a logical person, the logical proof of Loose Chain is much more logical than the proof given to me by the American government. And then they want to attack Afghanistan. Afghanistan, give me proof. They want to give proof to Musharraf. Why? And I speak so openly. Westerners believe in freedom of speech, but they don't like my talk. So what they do, then prevent me to enter in the country. I'm telling you, let's have a dialogue. As far as the question is concerned, who did it, keep it aside. I know that there were more than 3,000 human beings who were killed in Twin Towers. If you want the Islamic answer, as I mentioned in my talk, as per Surah Maida, chapter number 5, verse number 32, if anyone kills any other human being, unless it be for murder or for spreading corruption in the land, it is as though he has killed the whole of humanity. So whoever did the Twin Towers, whoever did it, whether it was inside job, whether American did or Muslim did, whoever did it, it is wrong, prohibited, haram, I condemn it. You tell Muslim did, I say, I don't know. Whoever did it, whether Muslim or non-Muslim, American, X, Y, Z, whoever did, more than 3,000 Americans were killed. Even if they were non-Americans in it, it is a haram. I also go on to say, more than 50 people were killed in the tube blast of London. In London tube blast, some say 52, some say 54. So I say more than 50. Where more than 50 people were killed, I condemn it. In Bombay, where there were train bomb blast in 2006, more than 180 people were killed. I condemn it. But I don't put a full stop there. I also say that I condemn the thousands of innocent people killed in Afghanistan, in Palestine, in Iraq. Now coming to the secret. Now I condemn 3,000 Americans killed, everyone is happy. I condemn more than 50 people killed in London tube blast, everyone is happy. I condemn more than 180 people killed in Mumbai, everyone is happy. But when I say I condemn the thousands of innocent people killed in Afghanistan, in Iraq and Palestine, the Home Secretary of UK doesn't like it, so she bans me. Freedom of speech. When you want to criticize the Prophet of Islam, Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, freedom of speech. And I said, I condemn the innocent people killed in Afghanistan. No, I'm careful, you know, because I'm a debater. Because if I say thousands of people killed, they say, oh, Zakir is supporting terrorists in Afghanistan. So I'm going out of my way to say thousands of innocent people killed in Afghanistan. They may be terrorists, Allahu Alam, I don't know. So I'm so careful. When I said America, I didn't say innocent Americans. As any American you kill, I condemn. in the Twin Towers, in the London bomb blast, in the Bombay bomb blast. But in Afghanistan, I said, innocent, so it doesn't go down the throat. You know why? Because Zakir gets large audiences, no? Today, the media wants to malign Islam, but if they have a person who's clarifying the picture of Islam, they want to ban him. Let's have a dialogue, come to common terms. So as far as killing innocent people, sister, whoever did it is to be condemned. But don't follow the media. The media today is the most powerful weapon in the world. It can convert black into white, can convert day into night, hero into a villain, villain into a hero.
That's why I said, doctor, from what I have heard.
I agree, your question was very
good. I'm not sure. Yes, I don't think anybody...
You're not like the American. Very good. And neither are you like the...
Thank you.
Are you like the Home Secretary of UK. Your question was very clear, and my answer is clear. Whoever did it, it is wrong killing any innocent people. And just one more I'd like to give. And incidents. When I gave a talk in Bombay on is there in the Muslim monopoly, I gave a talk. After the train bomb blast, the police of Bombay told me, Zakir, you're popular among the Muslims. Why don't you give a talk? And the Muslim said, oh, only Zakir is truthful. He can talk to the police. So I was on the edge of the sword. Both are telling me to give a talk. Bakra mil gaya. And I told there,